this stage of the game. I do know that Sear is wrestling outstanding the last month of the season.
He also won the Floyd Farron tournament at 113.
Yes, he did. That's right.
Oh, we got a reversal, or actually a takedown. Yep. He's got to cut him and get for a quick takedown.
So it's 5-3, and Cronin has been very aggressive to try and get this takedown, at least tie the match up. And he's now getting warned for stalling. And close to a throw, but you see, Hainis does come out with the win for 5-3.
Big win for Canton. Now we're get points.
Right. Now both mats are at 113. On mat two, upper right hand, you'll see Trevor Prey of Groton versus Luke Henninger. And on mat three, again, it's Stas Satura versus Jordan Sear. And right now it looks like
Sears up 2-0.
Sears up 2-0. Yep. This is a great weight class, actually, because it looks like, you know, between Henninger, Satura, and Sear, we have some common opponents here. I believe Sear lost to Henninger earlier in the year, but then Sear beat Satura. And then you throw in Prey, who's got a pretty good record, and he has wrestled Henninger twice this year, both good matches. So there really isn't a favorite coming out of this match. Being from Groton, I know Prey a little bit. I mean, I've been in the same wrestling with him, and I can't tell you how he's improved over the years to get to this point of wrestling. He's really a great athlete. Henninger, though, is really scrappy, and they might have wrestled each other close during the year, but you can see how aggressive both kids are right now.
Henninger, a freshman, Prey, a sophomore. Right. Meanwhile, Sutera, he's a sophomore. Jordan Sear, he is a senior.
Right. It's one of those few lower weight class seniors that you're going to see. Points are sure hard to come by when you get to this semifinal. I mean, you don't see many pins. You don't see many tech falls or anything like that. You're going to see matches that are going to come right down to the third period, last few seconds mostly. There you see Prey on a deep single, and he does get his two-point takedown. He has Henninger on his back. He's out of bounds. And you see right there kind of the style of Henninger. He likes to throw. And in that position right there, Prey did catch him on a throw. That's one of the risk rewards kind of thing to be in a thrower. I mean, you can look spectacular on the mat throwing these things, but sometimes you get caught,
yep,
just like he did there. Henninger quickly on his feet, Prey trying to get him down. And here's one of these things where a referee won't let a wrestler just stand up with him. He's got to return to the mat within about 5-6 seconds or else he's going to get called for stalling. Again, Tura and Sear locked in a pretty good battle down there. Henninger does get an escape.
Yep.
1 point escape. Now the score is 2-1 Prey.
Boy, Sutera working hard there, trying to get Jordan Sear on his back, trying to get that 2 points, but Sear get to his feet. Another thing that comes into play, injuries at this time
right here.
We see wrestlers get dinged up in the region. Sometimes they're not coming into the state tournament at 100%. We have had a couple of injury forfeits here at the state tournament. Always hate to see that.
Yeah, you sure do.
Kid works so hard to get here and then has a bad luck injury. And
right,
all of a sudden he's on the sidelines trying to cheer on his teammates.
And it is such a long season that when you battle in the wrestling room every single day, plus you go to tournaments, plus you go to duels, you know, it's a physical sport.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you can't tell me that any one of these kids don't have some dings and bruises along the way and they're not 100%.
I had one wretch league coach tell me nobody's at 100%
tournament
time.
That's right. Now you see on mat two, Prey is in the bottom position. Henninger on top. Prey has to try and figure out ways to get hand control and come up. And right now, Henninger's doing a nice job of controlling Prey on top. Prey right now is trying to get hand control, which is the most important thing you can do in the bottom position. He does get hand control, and he's up and scores an escape. He leads the match now 3-1. On mat three, again, that's quite a battle. Again, you can look at, you know, who's favored. Sear was supposed to be the favored wrestler coming to this tournament, but he's locked in a battle with a kid from a school that's not just fighting to get in the championship individually, but they're fighting for a championship team-wise. Mm-hmm. So you talk about pressures these kids have.
Yeah, I mean, there's freshmen and sophomores. And,
oh, my God.
And they're wrestling in these lighter weights.
Yeah.
And they've got, you know, the crowd here, a great crowd on hand here this morning at the Civic Center.
Right.
And, you know, especially with the team title on
Absolutely.
The line.
Absolutely. And you see Prey there in a front headlock position with Henninger. Henninger's kind of been doing a lot more shooting, a little bit more aggressive, but tell you what, Prey's right with him. I told you before, Prey did lose to Henninger twice this year, and every one of them has come down to that last period. Now Prey is getting warned for stalling. It's a kind of a reward for Henninger for being more aggressive throughout the year or throughout the match. Prey, a nice shot, pushed him out of bounds. Prey's got to be careful now, because next time he gets warned for stalling, that's a point for Henninger. Okay, over on mat three.
Still 2-0.
Still 2-0. We're getting down to the third period. About a minute left is all there is.
And, of course, we have two referees on each mat here at the state tournament.
There we get a point.
Now that's 2-1 with a minute to go.
Satira now has made the match a little bit closer with his escape. And now we're just going to see, you know, who's going to become more aggressive. You don't want to get too aggressive. I mean, you know, you don't want to.
Especially against a guy like Jordan Sarah.
Absolutely. I mean. And you see Prey here on a good double leg takedown. Henninger countered that very well. And now we're in a possible stalemate position. But we're right down to the end of the second period with Prey ahead 3-1. On mat three, you see a takedown by Sear, and he now leads the match 4-1. And that's on the bottom left hand of your screen.
You can follow all the action online, sdpb.org. We have links to the scoring updates. We'll be sending out updates on Twitter as well.
And I got to tell you, if you're watching our broadcast, something to really follow along is that track wrestling on computer. That's it really helps a lot. And on mat three, you see Jordan Sear of Canton defeats Stas Satira of Bonham by a score of 4-1. Good match.
Another big win for Canton. They're climbing up in the team rankings. They got two big wins. Bonham with two losses, so they tally no points. Now it'll be up to those wrestlers for Bonham Scotland to come back in the wrestlebacks. They can still get points.
Right, and we still have quite a battle here with Prey on top of Henninger. And here's what I was talking about earlier. Referees will not let a wrestler just stay on top and ride him out. He has to try and work for a fall or near ball points or a fall. Right now, he's got to get him back down to the mat.
And he does. Almost a reversal there.
Almost back. He's got him close to back points. Good job by Prey. On mat three, we have Dirk Wolf of Lemon.
Well, it's Lemon McIntosh.
Lemon McIntosh versus Dylan Colt of Elk Point Jefferson.
Down to a minute here. We have 113 weight class.
And you see Prey is still in the lead, 3-1. Doing a pretty good job of controlling Henninger. Again, Prey's got to get him back down on the mat. He can't just hang on to that, because a referee will be very quick, especially in the semifinal round, to call stalling. So he's got to do something with this. He can't just hang on, although I will say he's doing a good job of just hanging on to that leg and not allowing. There Henninger gets one, and the score now is 3-2-1, or 3-2. Now Prey's got to be careful. He can't just keep backing up. He has got to make some points, because if he gets stalling now, that ties the match up.
Uh-huh. And we saw that last year at the Class A.
Yep, there's a shot.
In the heavyweight, there was a stalling call with 3 seconds left.
14 seconds, 10 seconds. Oh, what a flurry of moves between Henninger and Prey. That was close points, both guys. We're down to 4 seconds left. Prey cannot back up. Prey cannot back up, or he's going to get dinged.
Oh, a little warning there. Start before the whistle.
Start before the whistle there. He's got to pull into him. And Prey comes out of there with quite a victory. Twice losing to Henninger throughout the year, and comes back to beat Henninger in probably the most important time of the year.
Yes.
So Great job for Prey. Good job.
Trevor Prey into the championship. And now Let's concentrate on mat number three. That's still 2-0 right there. And that, I believe, is Dylan Colt with the edge.
And to set up the mat on mat two here, you probably have one of the best wrestlers in the state with Duncan Stabner. One of the few undefeated wrestlers that we have in the state. He's taken on Logan Mahoney of Parkston.
These two guys very familiar with
yes,
each other
are
in the same conference.
Stabner, a multiple state champion for Bonham. Again, you would like to say that Stabner would probably be heavily favored in this match, but who knows? Who knows?
Stabner champion last year at 113, and he is unbeaten on the air for Bonham, Scotland.
And over on mat three, we still see the same score, 2-0.
Oh, check that. I thought it was Colt on top. Actually, I believe Dirk Wolf is ahead.
Yes.
Yep, from Lemon McIntosh. And again, we have some schools here, you know, that are combining with other schools. Yeah. Great example, Lemon McIntosh, Bonham Scotland, Burke Gregory. They've combined for a few years and put good teams on the mat.
They sure have, you bet. And when you have similar singlets, it makes it even more difficult.
Yeah.
Here you see Mahoney in on a nice double or a single leg, and that's just, you know, that's just Stabner for you. I mean, he'll take a situation where you think he's at a disadvantage, and he turns it into an advantage. And right there, he scored the first points of the match, two-point takedown, and almost back points.
I believe his father is a coach, isn't he?
Right, his father is the coach.
Isn't it amazing how those coaches' sons, they just know, they're great instinctive wrestlers. They know all the little things. You think they're in trouble, and boom, they got somebody on their back.
Well, I'll tell you what, it can be a blessing and a curse. I had two boys that wrestled, too, and I'll tell you what, my ticker hasn't been the same since.
I wonder, is the furniture around the house
intact? Yeah, well, we got some holes in the wall, and I'm not kidding you. We do.
This is the Class B Wrestling Tournament, sdpb.org. On mat three, still 2-0. That's in the second period.
I got to give Mahoney a lot of credit here. I mean, he's not afraid of Stabner one bit. I mean, this not intimidated at all. He just he got to his feet, almost scored an escape. There you got a Granby roll by Wolf. He's close to scoring a revert. Or not Wolf, that's Dylan Colt. No, that is Dirk Wolf. Right now, what he's trying to do is a Granby. Now, Granby is where you can kind of put the top wrestler in a cradle, and you get reversal and back points kind of all together. So it doesn't look like he's going to get that. Looks like Dylan Colt is still in control on top.
Time has expired.
Time has expired. Score remains 2-0. That's quite an advantage to have a wrestler ride out a kid on the top position for a whole period, because now he goes down, and like I told you before, it's easier to score points from the bottom position than it is to try and turn the wrestler over and score back points. Wolf is working hard. Wolf is in the bottom position on mat three. On mat two, you see Stabner controlling Mahoney.
Stabner is a senior. Mahoney, he is a sophomore. Dirk Wolf is a sophomore. Dylan Colt is a sophomore.
And I believe Stabner is a two-time state champ.
You are correct.
And there you see Mahoney getting a point escape.
And again, this match so important for team standings. Bonham, Scotland coming into today, number one. Parkston, two. Canton, three. And Beresford, four. Parkston came into the day 11 team points behind Bonham Scotland. Canton, they are 8 points behind Parkston.
And it looks like a point was awarded on mat 3-2. Wolf.
I just got an updated team score here. Canton now leads Bonham Scotland by 3.5 points.
Right.
So Bonham Scotland needs this match here.
Right. And I think you're going to see this thing going back and forth all day long. I really do. I think the competition between really three schools when you come down to it. And
I don't think Beresford can really catch it.
No, I don't
think they've had a good tournament, no doubt. But
and they can make a difference on who becomes state champion, too.
Absolutely.
They really can. So you know, you take a lot of pride. You may not be state champ, but I can make a difference on who becomes state champ, not just individually, but team-wise as well.
2-1 here, period.
And now you have 3-1. We have good match down on mat three. That's the bottom left hand of your screen.
And a point just got awarded, and now we're tied.
Now we're tied up.
3-3, 18 seconds left. Period three, that's mat three. Dirk Wolf, Dylan Colt.
And it's hard to tell, to distinguish between the two when you're seeing it on TV, on your screen. Wolf of
Lemon, he's in the blue.
Lemon, he's in the blue. With the, now you just see that there's Elk Point Jefferson.
That was Dirk Wolf. Dirk Wolf gets points. Yeah, Wolf gets the points.
That's
for
right.
Lemon McIntosh with a couple of seconds left. He's into the championship match.
Great match down there. Great match. Good effort.
Heartbreak for Dylan Colt. He tied it up with like a couple of, with 18 seconds left.
You know, why can't Rustin be more like basketball or football, which had opposite jerseys on? You know, it's kind of hard to distinguish between the two sometimes.
We're on to 126.
Okay.
It's on mat three. Meanwhile,
you have Dakota Galt of Beersford taking on Joshua Simonek of Hot Springs. And this could be a fun match to watch because both of these kids are extremely aggressive.
Galt has won his two matches under a minute combined.
Right. He's a fun wrestler to watch. If you like to see all the different kinds of throws and aggressiveness, that's what you're going to see in this match. And Galt is ahead. He scored a quick takedown. And
Simonek
got escape right away. So I think this is the kind of match you're going to see. You're going to see probably quick points, but both ways.
Meanwhile, 40 seconds left to go on the other man here, and Stabler's still up ahead of Mahoney.
I'll tell you what, Mahoney has done a great job wrestling against Stabler. I mean, Stabler is so good with technique and scoring points, and Mahoney has kept this match close, and that's, as an underdog, what you want to do. You want to keep a match close so that when you get to a position right where you're at right now, that you have a chance to score, and sometimes the favorite wrestler gets tight and, you know, gets a little bit nervous because all the pressure is on Duncan Stabner.
And how many times have you seen guys wrestle not to lose?
Oh,
and it
absolutely.
Ends up
hurting him. Absolutely. And it kind of almost looks like Duncan is in that right there. And you see Mahoney scrambling around trying to get that too, and he's close. If he locks that up, time did run out. Heck of a match. Heck of a match by Logan Mahoney of Parkston. Duncan Stabner came out with the win, but it was a heck of a match. And that's what you see in most semifinal matches, you really do.
Yeah, very rarely do you see pinfalls.
No, you don't. Okay, again over in mat four, you see Dakota Galt opening a little bit of a lead, 4-1 now.
On mat two here, it's Dylan Rice of Flandreau taking on Parker Ramstad of Tri-Valley. We are at 126 weight class right now on both mats.
You know, you look at all four of these kids right here, all are from Region 2. All of them are from Region 2.
Wow.
Galt came out of here as he won the region tournament. Rice from Flandreau was second. Ramstad was third. That tells you the quality of Region 1 wrestling. It really does. Or Region 2 wrestling. To have both, all, you know, three out of the four wrestlers in the state semifinals. That's pretty amazing.
We've seen that quite often at the Class A rankings with guys from Stevens, Sturgis, Rapid City Central populating the semifinals. Though Sioux Falls Roosevelt having a heck of a run at the state A tournament this year.
Look at that scurry of movement down there on mat three between Galt and Smith. They're just, that's why I love the semifinals. They just get after it all the time.
Team
score. Usually every dull moment.
Bonham Scotland back up on top. They lead by 7.5 points at the moment over Canton.
And there you see Dakota Galt close to a takedown, and he does. Opens that lead up a little bit more, 6-2 now, Galt. Over Sumanek. 126 pounds. That's kind of a trademark of Hot Springs Wrestling. It really seems like those kids, they like to throw. They like to be aggressive.
Hot Springs used to be a Class A school.
Yes,
of course, so did Canton, but they've moved down. They've had a few shifts in enrollment that have bumped a couple of schools in both directions.
Right.
You know, Harrisburg being the main one, moving up to Class A. And Hot Springs, of course, maybe a little more fortunate to be in the Class B region 4 instead of Class A region 4, where they're going up against Stevens and Central and Sturgis and Spearfish and Belle Fouche.
You know, they might think the same thing against, you know, teams like Parkston and Howard and, you know, that have been dominant wrestling programs over the years. And
for decades.
Yeah, it really has been. There you see 2 points awarded for Rice. He will score the first points of this match. And now he leaves Ramsted by 2-0, going into the second period. You know, that's the age-old conversation you get, who's better wrestlers between the A's and the B's. And, you know, let's just say they have both good quality wrestling.
And when you
both
have some of these, like the Floyd Farron Classic and some of these other classics, the B wrestlers hold their own.
Oh, they sure do.
And you know, there have been a number of them from both Class A and Class B that have had success wrestling collegiately.
Right. You know, Canton had a great showing at the Lee Wolf tournament up in Aberdeen, and of course Parkston won the Floyd Farron tournament at Lincoln. You know, so yeah, I mean, you know, I would say maybe team wise, you know, maybe the A's you'd see better team wise, but individuals, you know, who knows? Who cares?
There's good wrestlers out on the mat.
There is,
and every now and then you find that Lincoln McIlravey who makes it to the Olympics.
Yeah. Yep, that's for sure.
And you take a look, collegiate wrestling around here, Augustana, you know, has had some strong teams with mostly local kids.
Right. I just watched that Augie-St. Cloud State match just a few weeks ago. What tremendous wrestling that South Dakota provides for some of these area colleges, you know. And it's a sense of pride to see how well these guys do at the collegiate level.
10-2 now, the score on mat 3. Galt fully in control. Meanwhile, 3-0 here. This is mat 2.
Rice still leads Ramsted, 3-0. 50 seconds left in the second period. 55 seconds left on mat 3. Again, that's your lower left match on your screen. And it looks like Galt is firmly in control of that match. Not so much over here on mat 2, though. We got a pretty good match, even though Rice ahead by 3. You know, one takedown, that makes a big difference. He's right back in this match. So Ramsted, I'm sure you're going to see a little bit. Going to get after it here a little bit more. Looks like Ramsted got a pretty good black eye there, too. Again, Tri-Valley, one of those programs annually that usually has pretty good individuals. Maybe not so much the team-wise, but you always see Tri-Valley wrestlers that do really well in the semifinal and the finals. Good. Almost had a single leg there hooked up, Rice. Okay, we're down to 3 seconds left in the second period between Rice and Ramsted. Second period ends with Rice holding a 3-0 lead. And Ramsted will choose the bottom position.
Dakota Galt wins 12-5. He is into the championship at 126. He was up by 10 points, but then Simonek got some points there in the last few moments.
Yep.
That affects the team score because that went from a major decision to just a regular decision.
Now on mat 3, you see John Lamer of Canton, who is 34-1, going against Kelby Hawkins, who's 33-1. So you have some outstanding records. Lamer a little bit longer. You know, he uses leverage. Hawkins a little shorter, a little stockier. Pretty strong kid. Both are excellent with technicians. There you see Lamer in a shot. Hawkins counters well. You may not see a very high-scoring match over there.
Meanwhile, it's a minute 25 left, period 3, mat number 2, with Ramsted going up against Rice. Rice ahead 3-1.
On mat 3, I know Lamer is the number 1 rated wrestler in the state. I know Hawkins well, being in the wrestling room with Kelby. I had a good chance to watch Lamer a couple matches yesterday, and boy, such a good, hard wrestler, technique-wise. There you see Blood Time. I think that's Bloody Nose from Hawkins, maybe?
They're checking.
Or is that
him
Lamer? I don't know.
I think they're checking Lamer here.
Won't be the last time you'll see Blood in that match, probably.
Meanwhile, but under a minute to go here, and it's still 3-1 Rice over Ramstead. Yeah, yesterday, when I was watching the quarterfinal rounds, I saw a couple injuries, but not a whole lot of Blood Time.
No. I don't know if maybe they don't have much blood left in them after. I don't know.
Left it all in the practice mat.
That's right. Boy, there were some good quality matches in those quarterfinal rounds, though. My goodness.
Yep.
One in particular we'll talk about later. But, again, you're seeing good quality South Dakota wrestling here at the B level. Oh, there you see a takedown. Both Rice and Ramstead both went in for a shot at the same time, and Rice just kind of caught him there. That opens the lead up to 5-1 with 14 seconds left in this match. Looks like Rice will advance.
10 seconds. Dylan Rice, 42-10 entering this tournament.
There's Lamer with a deep single leg. Kelt Hawkins is trying to create a stalemate here. And he's got to hold on. He got 34 seconds left, and he's close. Lamer's close to getting that takedown, and right there you see the 2 points awarded. Lamer now is ahead of Hawkins by 2. And Lamer is kind of known as a leg rider. He's going to throw those legs in and try and turn over Hawkins there. Hawkins does a good job of scrambling. He's now deep in a single leg, trying to get that reversal. The last 8 seconds of the first period. He's close. Lamer hanging on. Hawkins got to try and clear that leg, and he's not going to do it. Score remains 2-0. Lamer over Hawkins after period one.
Meanwhile, on mat number 2, it is Brady Schatz of Potter County against Alex Saba of Bonham, Scotland.
Saba is a returning state champ.
Yep, he won last year at 120. Yep. This is the 132 weight class. We're on both mats, on the red mats in the semifinals.
Matter of fact, Kaba beat Hawkins in that final last year. So they both have some championship experience. Kind of hard to believe John Lamer didn't place last year, but now you see Hawkins with it. Well, now Lamer's going to get around behind Hawkins. No, Hawkins still has that single leg hooked up.
John Lamer of Canton finished second at the Floyd Farron tournament.
Right.
Lost to Taylor Bringle of Sturgis.
Right. Good wrestler in the A's, boy.
Yes.
I think you're going to see a stalemate here pretty quick between Hawkins and Lamer. Nobody's really getting an advantage here. Well, yep, I guess I spoke too soon. Lamer now gets that crossface in on Hawkins, steps around that back leg and gets the 2 points awarded. That's kind of the key in something like that when you're in that stalemate position. If that top wrestler can get that leg hooked in, then you're usually awarded 2 points. Hawkins now has got to do something. He's down by 4, 55 seconds left in that second period. Bottom position. Lamer is so good at using those legs that you might think that bottom wrestler might have an advantage here, but when Lamer gets those legs in, that's hard to score on those. Here on mat 2, which is the upper right screen,
that's Saba.
You see Kaba that scored the takedown, and I believe he was awarded 2 point near fall, or 3 point near fall.
Yep, that puts him ahead 5-0.
Kaba now leads 5-0. And there you see Schatz getting an escape. Score now 5-1. The Schatz Kaba match is on the upper right hand mat on your screen. Hawkins Lamer, bottom left. And there you see Hawkins trying to come out back door, but that's a perfect example of Lamer using legs. So good at tying that bottom wrestler up. You know, that can be a defensive move, it can be an offensive move. Depends on what situation that bottom wrestler puts himself. We have 21 seconds left in the second period. Hawkins down 4-0 to Lamer. And here we're talking team points again. You got two kids here on both semifinal matches, Canton and Bonham.
Currently Bonham Scotland in the lead, but Canton right behind them. Parkston still in the mix. They're in third place, Beersford in fourth, and hats off to Beersford. They brought 11 wrestlers to the state tournament this year.
That program in the last 5 years has really just blossomed, exploded into a good quality program.
And you take a look, you know, Elk Point Jefferson's had strong teams.
Yes.
Dakota Valley has had strong teams in the past. They've been down a little bit this year, and mm-hmm. Beersford stepped into that vacuum and stepped up because they've had great individuals
this year. On mat three, time ran out. Lamer leads Hawkins 4-0. And Hawkins chooses neutral position, so they're going to start on their feet. You know, I always like wrestling those taller kids for some reason. I don't know, but those tall kids that have good technique, they're so long and lanky that, you know, they can create so much offense with length, you mm-hmm. know, and so much leverage with length. You know, they hook those legs in or they put the long arm in and put a half an Nelson in or something like that. And it's hard for a lot of kids to wrestle those tall kids.
Got a blood timeout again on match three. So let's concentrate on what we've got here on match two.
We have a good match.
Schatz has come back. He's within a couple of points. Under a minute to go, period number two. Saba still leads 5-3.
And again, here's where Schatz just wants to keep the match close until right at the end, which he's doing. He's in the top position right now. It's so difficult to turn a good quality wrestler over to his back to earn a near fall or a pin. You might have to see a situation pretty close now. If he doesn't score in the next couple of seconds, he might want to turn him loose and try and score from the top. But you see right there, there's a possibility of back points. He's got the legs hooked in. He's got the far side half in. If he can straighten out his legs, straighten Cobb out a little bit, he might get some back points, but time is running out on that second period.
9 seconds left. Shots
right
working
there. He's got
so
a deep
hard.
There we go. I don't know if he's.
Ran out
think
of time.
The towel tapper missed the referee. I don't think that the point scored, but for a reversal there for Kaba, but I'm not sure. I don't think there was going to be any points awarded.
The officials.
There you see Lamer. Good double leg takedown on Hawkins, and Lamer now opens up a 6-0 lead. And just like I thought, there wasn't. I guess he did award a
no points awarded
here.
Oh, no, he gave him the escape.
Gave him the escape. Yep,
he gave him the escape. So it's now 6-3.
Again, what I was talking about earlier, it's going to be hard to turn him over. He might want to let Schatz now might want to consider letting up Kaba if he can't turn him. Because a 6-3 match is, you know, if you're on the bottom, it's a pretty commanding lead when you think about it. You know, the bottom wrestler doesn't really have to do a lot to preserve that win. So we'll see what strategy Schatz going to have now. They're on mat three on the lower left hand of your screen. Hawkins now is close to a reversal, or at least an escape, or a takedown, I should say. I'm sorry. But he's got to get his head out, up on top and around behind. Yep, we have, it looks like, a win for John Lamer of Canton. Here we go back and forth again with that Canton, Bonham, Scotland.
6-1, the final there, as Canton gets some important team points. Meanwhile, Alex Saba hanging on to a 6-3 lead, 1:09 left, trying to keep Bonham Scotland ahead of Canton. They are 1-2 in the team standings. Meanwhile, we move on to Michael Scott of Stanley County versus Luke Loudenberg from Howard, one of the more familiar faces on the football field and on the wrestling mats.
I don't think you're going to find probably a better wrestler in the state, really, when you think about it.
Yep, he is signed to play football at Dakota Wesleyan. Although I know a lot of college wrestling coaches were probably talking to Luke Loudenberg as well, but football, I think, was just a greater passion for him.
I think so. And You know, that kind of stems from how many years has he wrestled? You know, a lot of these kids will start when they're in kindergarten or pre-kindergarten. Honestly, they get burnt out, you know, before they're seniors. So football kind of becomes a natural passion for these kids that haven't played it as many years. This is I'll tell you what, this could really turn into be a pretty good match.
Let's not sell Michael Scott short.
No,
8-2.
I love watching Michael Scott wrestle because he is a thrower. You never know where the match is going to be. He will take a throw any chance he gets. I love watching him wrestle. I've watched him for 3 years now, and he's just a fun kid to watch wrestle. And he will not be intimidated by Luke Loudenberg, I can tell you that right now.
Alex Saba wins 6-3, so bottom Scotland gets some more
back
important
the
team points.
Back to the finals for
Alex Saba. Now that will set up Garrett Roush of Potter County versus Kyle Fowler of Elk Point Jefferson. That'll be on mat two. That'll start here in a moment. Meanwhile, no score between Scott and Loudenberg. Loudenberg going for a fourth championship.
That's pretty amazing.
A two-time Joe Robbie winner in football as a sophomore and a senior. So this is one of the most decorated high school athletes we've seen come down the pike in a while. And he's not a big guy, but I tell you what, is there a guy that wrestles with more determination and heart or competes on the football field than Luke Loudenberg?
I'd love to take a look at his trophy case.
It's pretty full. And I tell you what, Dakota Wesleyan got a big score by getting that young man. And a good young man, too. Pleasant young man to talk to.
I don't know why. You know, I had two boys that went through the recruiting process and you know, in college football. Sometimes they don't put enough stock into size. You know, they have to be a certain size before they're recruited. You know, they have to be, you know, whatever. But they don't judge heart sometimes.
Yep.
You know, and I'll tell you what, that's a kid over there that has a lot of heart. And you're right, they picked up a great recruit in Luke Loudenberg. Right now, he's in for a battle, though.
Yep.
Michael Scott and Luke Loudenberg tied after the first period.
Scott is a junior. Loudenberg, of course, a senior. Garrett Roush, that young man's a junior from Potter County. Kyle Fowler is a senior from Elk Point Jefferson.
Now, Kyle Fowler's kind of an interesting story. He moved in from Ohio after his junior year. Elk Point Jefferson picked up quite a wrestler. He wrestled in Ohio for, you know, however long, I'm not really sure, but he's made a very positive addition to that wrestling room. There you see Fowler scoring 2 points. Takedown. Tell you the kind of the quality wrestler Fowler is. Loudenberg and Fowler were tied 1-1 in their region championship match. Loudenberg caught him at the end and scored a 5-point move. But, you know, to stay with Loudenberg 1-1 last 15 seconds of the match tells you something about the quality of kid he is.
Luke Loudenberg did win the Floyd Farron tournament in Sioux Falls. Yep. And of course, that matches some of the top teams from A and B. And it's one of those mid-season tournaments that's really kind of one of those bellwether tournaments.
They are fun to watch, aren't they?
And I tell you what, the competition at the Floyd Farron is top
it
notch.
It is.
Year after year.
Over there, we have Luke Loudenberg. Now he got a quick escape after being on the bottom of the referee's position, started period two, and he got a takedown. Now he leads Michael Scott by 3. On mat 2, Fowler still leads 2-0. That's on the bottom, or excuse me, that's on the top right of your screen. Even I get confused watching these screens.
Yeah, because it goes 1, 2, 3,
right.
4 across.
Right.
Mats 1 and 4 are the wrestle back mats, the blue mats, the semifinals on the red mats. Loudenberg still up 3-0. That's winding down period number 2.
We're just starting period 2 over here on mat 2. Fowler chooses the bottom position. And there you see Roush. Deep, tight waist. That's how you want to control those bottom wrestlers. Tries to throw a leg in, trying to create a potentially dangerous situation there, but the ref's going to let him wrestle. On mat 3, at the end of 2, Michael Scott decides he wants to try and go both up in neutral position. He didn't do much on the bottom. So why not? He's a thrower. Let's get him on the feet.
Loudenberg coming in, just one loss on the season.
That was close.
Just
there
two.
There you see on mat 2, a potential tilt position or a position by Roush. He's got that wrist locked up and underneath, and all he has to do is try and get him over on his hip to create a near fall. But now Fowler now got that arm clear. Back up to referees. Again on mat three between Loudenberg and Scott. Neutral position. You know, here's where Loudenberg might want to switch his strategy a little bit. I mean, he's up by three. Last minute of the match. He may not want to be overly aggressive. Because if you're overly aggressive with Michael Scott, he's going to throw you and he's going to make you pay. So Loudenberg has to be kind of careful here. He's not going to, you know, you got pride factors and all that kind of stuff. I'm a multiple-time state champ. I should be kicking his butt. But you know what? You got dangerous wrestlers no matter who they are at the semifinals.
You can't be too overconfident.
No.
And look at their
And there you go. That was a perfect example. Michael Scott tries to lateral drop him to the edge of the mat. Close.
Yep.
You know? This is why it's hard on wrestling moms and dads. You know? All the success that Luke Loudenberg's had over the years, I know his dad very well. I guarantee you he's up there, his heart's ticking a million miles away.
Meanwhile, here's Roush.
I'll tell you what.
Trying to make a comeback here. Period number two, he's down 2-0.
Roush is doing a heck of a job riding out Fowler for almost the entire period. 20 seconds left in this period. Again, Michael Scott's got to try something now. 15 seconds left in the match. He's still down 3-0. Loudenberg kind of at the edge of the mat. He's not going to do anything. He's not going to try and do anything dumb where he's going to get himself in a position where he's going to get thrown. Now you're going to see Michael Scott really taking off after Loudenberg with 8 seconds left in the match. You're going to try and see a throw. 5 seconds left, four. There's your try. And the match ends. Luke Loudenberg. Again, it's like home sweet home to him. Championship match. 3-0 win over Michael Scott. Good match by Scott, though.
Meanwhile, Fowler and Roush doing battle here. Mat number two, minute 35 and counting. Period number three, Fowler up 2-0. Over on mat three, we're going to have Blake Beats of Parkston against Rance Johnson.
Now, I believe Johnson has beaten Beats one time this year in an earlier tournament.
Beats, the winner of the Floyd Farron tournament back in December.
And he is a former state champ. Last year, I believe he placed third. Former state champ, and he's only a sophomore. You know, again, good.
Johnson out of Phillip area.
The thing I like about these Phillip kids, and they come out to the state tournament. You don't get a chance to see them very often, being an East River school coach. But when I see them, they're always just solid, hard-nosed kids. Yep. You know, they never get beat because they're wimpier or they're not more physical. And here you see, you got a scramble right here between Fowler and Roush. There's back points being awarded by Fowler, on Roush. And you're going to see 2 points awarded to Fowler on kind of a scramble situation. They kind of got into that place where Roush was trying to make a move. Kind of got stopped by Fowler, and he got 2 point near fall from it. Over the match, you see it looks like Beats has a 2 point takedown over Johnson. He leads early in his match, 2-0. And we're down to 30 seconds left of this match. And you see Fowler just kind of hanging on to that, probably. We got some. What? There's been some good scrambles in this match. Fowler remains on top, 15 seconds left in the match. And you're going to see Fowler just kind of hanging on as much as he can. Keeping him on the mat, 3-2-1. Good match. We're going to have a repeat of the region championship between Fowler and Loudenberg at 138.
4-0 the final there at 138.
Now we're moving up. to match 306. That's Bailey Neesis of Howard at 28-2 versus Nathan Jones of Britton Heckle at 42-2.
Last year, Beats third at 132, Jones fourth at 132.
Neesis, I believe, is a former state champ. And you can kind of look at the different styles between both wrestlers there. If you look at Jones, who's on the upper right hand of your screen, very stocky, very muscular. Beats is maybe a little lankier. Quite a technician. I've watched him wrestle for years. Good quality, solid kid. Okay, we have a 2-2 score down there on Johnson Beats. He's getting 2 points.
Philip Area, the runner-up the last 2 years in a row to Parkston, but they didn't bring as many wrestlers to the state tournament this year.
Can you see Parkston trying to play a little bit of a role in the team title? If Beats can win this match, there you see over here, Neesis scores the takedown, and quickly Jones gets the escape. Score now, Neesis 2 and Jones 1. Tied up score down on mat 3. That would be on the lower left of your screen between Johnson and Beats. And that's 1 minute left in the second period.
Get you the updated team scores. Bonham on top by 7.5 points over Canton. Parkston third place, but they're falling behind. They're 21.5 points behind Canton at the moment.
There you see Johnson on a deep shot on Beats, but Beats counters. You know, we talk a lot about these semifinals and the scores going back and forth, but I got to tell you, and it's too bad we can't focus a lot on these wrestlebacks because they play a huge picture.
Absolutely.
On who's going to win this championship too. And I'll tell you what, you're going to start hearing a lot more from Parkston Wrestling now because they're going to have some kids coming up in the semifinals. They have a lot of kids in the wrestlebacks. You get third place in the wrestlebacks, that also adds up to your team score. So don't count Parkston out yet.
Nope, they're definitely not out of it, but they're going to have to make some hay in
they
those
do.
Wrestlebacks.
Yep.
And I always remember one of the years at this A tournament, Sturgis won the team title. They didn't have a single wrestler on Saturday night.
Right.
They had a bunch of guys in the third, fifth, and seventh. They had no individual champions and yet won the team title.
Right. And you know, you don't see that very often. You see that once in a while. I'm from Mitchell. I wrestled for Mitchell a long time ago. But, you know, they won a state title like that, too. They didn't have any state champs or anything like that. That shows you the importance of these wrestlebacks. You know, it's like I said before, it's too bad we can't focus a little bit more on these wrestlebacks because we have the semis. But they're just as important in a lot of ways for the team title. And now you see Beats opening a one-point lead with an escape on mat 3. The Johnson Beats match is on your lower left-hand mat on your screen. You see Neesis on a double-leg takedown. He's going to open up a 5-1 lead over Jones.
Howard in sixth place in the team standing. Elkpoint Jefferson fifth at the moment.
Well, you're going to see Howard start making some moves here, too. I mean, you had Loudenberg. Now you have Neesis. You have some other wrestlers coming up. Caleb Haas will be up here. Mm-hmm. Wrestling for too long. You have Tanner Henkel.
Yep.
So, I mean, you know, Howard's going to, they may not have a chance for the team title, but you know what?
They could get a better team title,
right,
or a better team trophy. Action stopped here. We have a clock issue here.
And our screen went dead too, so that's terrifying.
Well, our screen just came back here at our broadcast location, but the scoreboard here for mat number 2 just went dead, so they're trying to figure out what's going on here. Meanwhile, mat number 3, this one's coming down to the wire.
Sure is. 30 seconds left.
Yep, 3-2. I believe that's
with
Beats on top.
Beats on top. And I got to say, if Parkson's going to make any kind of movement, it has to start here. So right now, you see Stalling, and 1 point's going to be awarded
That was an
to
escape.
Johnson.
Yeah, that was an escape by Johnson.
Escape by, yeah. And that was the warning. That was a warning point, I believe.
Oh, is that a warning? Okay, a warning point there.
So we got a tied up match. 14 seconds left. You got Beats on a deep single double, and he does get 2 points in the last 4 seconds of the match to earn a 5-3 victory. What a match!
So Blake Beats advances 5-3 over Rance Johnson.
You know, I can't believe when people at home watch matches like this or in the crowd, why the numbers aren't up in wrestling. Because how can you not be a fan, no matter what sport you follow, of wrestling when you see matches like that where kids go out there and they lay it on the line. They are so gutsy athletes. And that's what they are. They're athletes when they come out here and do things like that. And I know it's hard to lose matches when you're out on the mat. You're one-on-one, nobody else to blame, that kind of stuff. But when you see matches like this, you wonder why more kids don't want to compete as wrestlers. You know, it just kind of blows me away why numbers are dropping.
Well, some of that has to do with the enrollments at schools smaller.
That's true.
And you've had to have some schools combine and co-op, so there's opportunities there. But, you know, it's one of those things, you know, it sometimes depends on the coach, the tradition
that's
in that
true.
Particular town.
That's true.
Support from the parents and parents' organizations.
Right.
There's a lot of factors that go into it.
Absolutely.
And, you know, always want to encourage young men and young women to compete in whatever sport, whether
that's
it's golf,
point.
Volleyball, track and field, wrestling, football, basketball.
Good point.
Cross country. Get out there and compete.
That's
you
right.
never know until you get out there and try.
Yeah, you know, athletics is taught me so much in my life, you know, and when I see these kids that don't compete in whatever sport, you know, it kind of tears at me a little bit. But anyway, I'm at on mat three, match 309. Here's one of the better wrestlers in the state too. It's Jacob DeSursa of Hot Springs taking on Nick Casperson of Beersford. This is only a freshman going against a junior in DeSursa. Another one of those good young Beersford kids coming up.
Yep, Casperson, a freshman.
Right.
He is 41-3. DeSursa is 42-3. Meanwhile, we're still going down to the wire here between Nisus and Jones, with Nisus up 5-2, minute five.
Now
we got a stalling call.
A stalling point.
Oh, that's yep. That is a point for Nisus, so that makes the hill a little taller to climb for Nathan Jones,
the senior. Nathan's got to get up and with those legs in deep, it's hard to score any points on the bottom. There you call a stalemate. They start over. Jones has got to make something happen soon. Again, over on mat three, which is on the lower left of your screen, Casperson of Beersford, DeSursa of Hot Springs, still in the neutral position, kind of feeling each other out. Last 15 seconds of the first period. Again, Casperson, freshman, DeSursa, a junior.
All the action here at sdpb.org. Our television coverage on SDPB2 television begins tonight at 5 Central, 4 Mountain Time. Meanwhile, looks like Nisa's totally in control here.
Yep. And it looks like he's going to go on to the state finals once again. The former state champ looking to reclaim his title. And good match by Jones.
6-2, the final there. And that will set up on mat two here momentarily. It'll be Daniel Slama of Stanley County versus Nolan Ritchie of Webster.
Ritchie, a former two-time state champ from Webster. Slama, one of those Stanley County kids. Fun to watch. Tell you what, they've really, the Stanley County program has really blossomed and exploded over the last couple of years. Their coach has done a good job of getting kids to wrestle and wrestle his style, which is fun to watch. It's fun to watch these throws and things like that. Looks like we have a 1-0 score on mat three with DeSursa taking, or is Oh, that would be Kasperson taking the early 1-0 lead on mat two, which is the upper right hand mat on your screen. Nolan Ritchie has taken an early 2-0 lead. His brother Logan is coming up on in a few minutes at 170.
Again, Webster, one of those strong wrestling towns.
Tell me about it. We had to wrestle them every year. Matter of fact, this is the first year Webster had that 63-match winning streak ended by Milbank earlier this year. I don't know if that's ever going to be broke. Most of these wrestling teams now go to tournaments, don't do them much anymore.
Yeah, duels, because of the schedule and travel, a lot of teams, they get most of their matches in by traveling
right.
to tournaments and invitationals. The duels, with fewer and fewer schools, there are conference duels and some teams that do that.
Right.
But it seems to be fewer and fewer. It seems like it's more of, get your matches in at
right.
Tournaments.
All right, there you see a two-point takedown awarded by DeSursa, who takes a 2-1 lead over Kasperson.
Meanwhile, we have Ritchie with a 2-0 lead here on mat number two in the first period.
Nolan Ritchie going for a three-time state champion. Although you're never going to believe what he's going to college for.
I'm interested to hear.
Rodeo.
Rodeo.
He is going to Oklahoma on a rodeo scholarship. Now he looks like he's wrestling right here. He always gets close to a near fall, and then Slama gets out of it, and he is going to score 2-point reversal. We're going to tie the match up at the end of the second period. On mat three, Kasperson now looks like he is going to score a reversal, or close to, or what's, why is the referee waiting?
Kasperson from Beersford on top. Again, that young man just a freshman.
DeSursa, though, is in the lead. I'm not sure why the referee, he has two fingers down. I'm not really sure why he's waiting to. Oh, he had scored a near fall. That's what it was. And Kasperson still has the wing locked up. Until that wing is released, the referee will not award that near fall. Now, he's got a chance to score a 3-point near fall on DeSursa, which he has, and he's close to a fall. Right now, Kasperson will be ahead of the match after the 3-point near fall is awarded. If Kasperson can hold him there, he wins the match.
30 seconds left. DeSursa in trouble for Hot Springs.
This would be quite an upset. He's got to hang on. 22 seconds left. You're going to see 2 points awarded for, now look at that. 3 points awarded for the near fall, 2-point reversal, and now points for DeSursa, back points for DeSursa.
We're tied at 4.
What a scramble. No, now we've got 2 points. DeSursa now is ahead by 2. With 1 second left, a 1-point escape.
6-5.
We end up with a 6-5, and I'm out of breath trying to keep up with that one.
And that's the end of the third period.
And DeSursa, they better check their points because those points came fast and furious.
Now I believe the Hot Springs coach coming over to, or the Beersford coach rather, coming over to check things out. Want to make sure the scoring is correct.
We'll check on that one later right here on mat two, which is on the upper right-hand mat on your screen. Slama is on top. He's the wrestler that was on top to start the period. Stalemate. Slama locks in those legs. Good leg rider. Ritchie remains in the bottom position. The score is 2-2.
And the winner is DeSursa. Wow, 6-5.
What a match. What a match.
He was a heartbeat away from being pinned and comes back in a flurry.
Right. He was on his back with the referee close to calling
With
30 seconds left, he was less than that. And then he manages to not only get out of that move, to put Kasperson on his back and get back points.
Unreal. What a semifinal. Yeah. And DeSursa is on to the championship. Meanwhile, Nolan Ritchie, Daniel Slama, this is a tight one, second period, 3-2.
Referee has awarded 2 points. Looks like he's got him in that Granby position. That's how quick this match can change. I mean, you know, and he's going to get awarded, I believe, 2 or 3 point near fall for those back points. Got to be kind of careful with Slama, though. He's kind of like what happened on that other match. He can score points from anywhere. And now we got Nolan Ritchie close to scoring the near fall. He's got him on his back. He's close. We've got 10 seconds left in the second period. And he gets the fall for Webster.
So Nolan Ritchie.
I believe Nolan Ritchie will be in the finals, winning two of those previously.
So it'll be Ritchie versus DeSersa. That ought to be a dandy at 152. Meanwhile, let's move on to 160. On the mat currently is Tanner Hinkle, the senior out of Howard. He is taking on Austin Rip, the junior out of Parkston.
And here's another one of those Howard wrestlers. They know Howard's, you know, I believe they're going to be favored in most of these matches.
Yes.
If they can put 3 or 4 guys in the finals, my gosh, you're going to start seeing Howard moving up those that team standing as well.
We got 2-0 to score there, and it looks like that is Hinkle on top. Meanwhile, it is Sam Ireland taking on Noah Beck. We're at 160 weight class on both mats. Beck, a junior out of Burke Gregory, and Ireland out of Bennett County.
And you see a tie score.
And we've got a near fall situation where Hinkle gets 3 more points. Check that, 2 more points.
Yep.
Rip from Parkston, desperate for team points.
Right.
Because Howard could definitely going to leapfrog some people here.
Well, I'll tell you what, Beck is coming out physical. Ireland probably, he's one of those 3 undefeated wrestlers in the state tournament at 38-0. But Beck, again, these kids aren't intimidated by records alone or what they've done in the past or whatever. He's really being aggressive with Ireland. Beck, part of that football program that won the state title this year for Gregory. And there you see Beck kind of almost releasing Ireland. Ireland now has a 3-2 lead, 30 seconds left in the first period. And over on mat 3, you see Hinkle with a 4-0 lead over Rip of Parkston. You know, you think of the pressures these kids have just to go out there and wrestle a match. The additional pressure of winning a state title for your team has to add to that. But you know what? I think that carries a lot of incentive, a lot more incentive when you think about it, that you're not just wrestling for yourself. You're wrestling for your team. You're wrestling for your school, your community, and all those other great Parkston wrestling teams over the last 5 years. I won't say last 5 years, probably last 25 years, really.
Yes. Yeah, they have had dominant teams so many, many years. Got an update for you. Team standings. Howard's moved up to number 4. They've just edged ahead of Beersford. So Howard in the 3 spot, or checked at the 4 spot. They're still about 25 points behind Parkston.
Well, I'll tell you what, if they win here, you know, making a move at 160.
Parkston, of course, has a wrestler coming up at 170, but so does Howard. They'll be on separate mats.
You see 2 points, I believe, are going to be awarded for near fall for Ireland here in the second. I don't know why he's hanging up. Oh, he still has that tilt position hooked up. Ireland, a master at the tilt. Get these cheap tilts, which means that they just turn them over for a fraction of a second or 2 seconds, they get near falls. That's what he was awarded right there. Ireland now with a 5-2 lead.
Well,
Beck.
We have blood timeout over on the third mat number 3. That is Henkel and Rip in a 160-pound semifinal.
You know, I've never known what it was like to be undefeated as a wrestler, but you would think that towards the end of your senior year, to have that kind of hanging over you a little bit, it's a great honor to have that, but what kind of pressure does that compete with that individual? I mean, everybody's different. You know, sometimes kids get a little more defensive when they get this age. Your last match, your last tournament.
And the guy across the mat wants to knock you off, and they know they're going up against an unbeaten guy.
Oh, they sure do. They know exactly who they're wrestling, what their records are, who they're from, where their teams are, where the standings are. And we got 30 seconds left of period two. Henkel with a commanding 4-1 lead over Rip. But you know what? Shoot, that can change in a hurry. Look at that last match we had between, you know, Kasperson and DeSursa. How fast things can change there. That might be one of the better matches. That was probably, if not the best match of the tournament, right up there.
We still have the finals yet to go.
Yeah, we'll talk about that similar Jensen match here in a few minutes, but
that's going to come up here at the was it the 195 weight class?
Okay, end of period two on mat two. Ireland opens up a little bit bigger lead on Beck, 7-2.
Again, our television coverage tonight at 5 Central, 4 Mountain Time, SDPB2 television. You can also watch it right here online at sdpb.org.
Not much change in scoring. You know, sometimes the bigger you get, the less, I won't say, well, they don't scramble as much as these little guys do. You know, they're big and strong, and they'll use a lot of power and things like that. You're getting these middleweights where it's kind of a combination of both. You know, you don't see the scrambling like the little kids. You don't see the muscle and the bigness of the, you know, the upper weights. That's why I like watching these middleweights. They kind of have a combination of both styles. You know, they're fun to watch. They, you know, a little bit bigger, a little bit older. I think that has a little bit to do with it too. You know, you get to see more juniors and seniors wrestling now that have a lot more knowledge.
A lot more experience.
Yeah, a lot more experience.
Meanwhile, Henkel's up 6-1 there.
I was going to say, these younger kids, they don't, there's no pressure to these kids. I mean, shoot, they're babies still on the mat. They just come out there and have fun. Older kids, they get nervous more.
We're at the 160 weight class here in Rapid City at the Rushmore Plaza Civic Center.
I do know that, boy, if Rip could have a chance to get on top, he's a heck of a cradler. You know, he had a really good semifinal match with Jordan Lovery of Duel. And, boy, that ended in a hurry when he put him in a couple of cradles and the match was over. So Rip is dangerous. And you know what? A lot of those Parkston kids are good at cradles. You know, one of the kids that... Oh, there we see the... And one of the kids that's not wrestling the tournament for Parkston this year, Brady Reef, was such a good cradler. It's kind of a shame we're not watching him wrestle for a
Parkston,
a three-time state champ.
Yeah, he's already attending classes down at the University of Iowa.
Something?
He had enough credits to graduate, and so he did. And we have a final here. Henkel's going to move on for Howard, a 6-1 decision over Rip. So Tanner Henkel, more points for Howard as they are charging up the team standings, and they're going to have another wrestler on the mat here in a moment. Meanwhile, 8-2, late third period, Sam Ireland of Bennett County on his way perhaps. Still got a little more to go. Got a blood timeout here. Meanwhile, let's go over to mat number three. That's 170-pound semifinal underway, Wes Dvorak of Parkston. Jared Harkless of Hot Springs. This should be interesting.
You know, Dvorak is one of these top grade wrestlers in South Dakota, A or B, it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Harkless comes from a long line of family Harklesses that have wrestled for Hot Springs over the year. Very, very good quality brothers from the Hot Springs area.
At the Floyd Farron tournament, Dvorak finished second to Brett Bai of Vermilion. Tanner Hinkle was third in that tournament. And, right. Of course, Brett Bai, I believe, is on to the University of Nebraska.
Arguably our best wrestler from the state of South Dakota this year.
At any weight class.
At any weight class, right, right. And so for him to stay on the same mat and make it halfway is a decent match. Says something a little bit about Dvorak. You know, Parkston, as a team, went to Minnesota and wrestled in that Clash tournament, which is a national tournament in Minnesota, and did very, very well. So when you're seeing these records from Parkston, they're a little bit deceiving because they've wrestled some of the best wrestlers in the nation at this tournament. So, sure, West Dvorak is 31-5. Now, how many of those losses came at the Clash in Minnesota? Probably a few of them.
Well, we know one of them came at the hands of Brett Bai,
right,
who's going to be going on to Nebraska.
Right.
And they have a top-notch wrestling program as Sam Ireland wins here. 8-2 the final. Congratulations, Sam Ireland, still unbeaten, the senior from Bennett County. Meanwhile, 2-0. And that is Dvorak on top.
Right.
Over Harkless, who himself is 19-1 and is a senior.
Those Harkless just energize his bunnies. They just keep going and going and going. That doesn't change from brother to brother, I can tell you that. On mat two,
yep,
we have Caleb Haas of Howard going against Logan Ritchie. His brother Nolan just won a semifinal match to earn the right to be in the championship, and Logan is looking to do the same thing with his brother.
Logan, a sophomore, Haas is a senior.
There you see over there, Dvorak has Harkless on his back, put him on his back with a wing, and he's going to get at least 3-point near fall. Dvorak, such a good technician. I mean, you look at what you want as the perfect wrestler, I think you're looking at him right over there. Technique, strength, quickness, smarts. But again, Harkless can be a very dangerous wrestler. He's one of those kids that if you let down for a second, he will make you pay. There is no doubt in my mind that I don't care what the score is. It can be 14-0. You might be in close, you know, almost ready to
tech fall,
and he'll throw you in back and get pinned. Well, that happened to Logan Storley a few years ago. If you remember that at the Aberdeen tournament, he was wrestling a kid from Fargo. He was dominating the match 14-0. Kid rolls him over and pins him. So, I mean, it's a good lesson to learn.
Storley, I believe, is at the University of Minnesota.
Senior year. Well, I've watched him for years and years and years, and kind of sad to see him done. You know, he's currently ranked number 3 in the nation. 3 or 4, something like that. 3, I believe.
Yeah, it seems like the older we get, the faster these young men and young women who we see in various sports, we see them compete for so many years, and all of a sudden, they're done with college.
Well, I don't want to talk about that age thing. I'm getting old enough the way it is. There you see Richie with a nice single leg. Got him down to the mat, just not long enough to control Haas right there. I believe he can get his knees down to the mat. Oh, he did. They gave him the takedown. Richie now up 2-0.
5 seconds left, period number one. Meanwhile, Dvorak in control over Harkless, 8-1 at the moment. At the A tournament, they're already into the consolation semifinals. So for those of you who have stepped away from the A tournament to see the semifinals here at Class B, we welcome you to the Rushmore Plaza Civic Center. Along with Scott Thorson, I'm Steve Toome. Tonight, we will have television coverage at 5 Central, 4 Mountain Time, but we still got a lot of ways to go.
Sure,
we're at 170. That's the weight class on the mats. The red mats are the semifinals here at the Class B. We have West Dvorak against Jared Harkless. That is on the bottom left part of your screen. Meanwhile, Caleb Haas against Logan Ritchie. That is on the top right. The blue mats are the wrestlebacks, for those of you just joining us.
Has there been a boring match yet?
No.
I honestly have not seen, I mean, there's been, you know, 3 or 4 point difference, but I haven't seen a boring match yet. Great matches at this year's state semifinals.
Again, we have Howard and Parkston battling for the third and fourth spots, and they have wrestlers for their respective teams on the mats at the moment.
Now
these
you look
big,
at
big matchups.
You look at strategy now for Dvorak. I mean, he's comfortably ahead, right? He's got an 8-9-1 lead right now over Harkless. Common sense would say back off a little bit. You know, take your win, get in the finals, whatever. Again, here's where he's wrestling for the team as well. He wants to get as many points, tech fall, near fall, I mean a pin or
major
whatever.
A major decision,
whatever it takes. So here's where you got to be kind of careful. It's kind of a fine line there to be being overly aggressive and being dumb.
But you don't want to shut down the factory.
No,
yeah.
No, you don't want to shut it down. You know, if that was me, I mean, I'm running all over the mat trying to save that 8-1, 9-1 lead. But extra incentive.
Meanwhile, we have Richie and Haas doing battle here. This is a 2-1 match, 35 seconds in counting, period number two. And it is
Richie ahead by one.
It is one. Richie ahead by one, yes. He is the sophomore out of Webster, 35-8. Haas is 38-4.
I remember this kid when he was wrestling 106. Logan Richie. He's eating his potatoes well, I might add. Right now, we have a lot of, you know, wrestlers, when you get to this stage of the game, you know, setups are so important. You know, you don't just shoot in on a double, you don't just shoot in on a single. Setups are what really makes the takedown. You know, you're trying to pound the head, you're trying to do a drag with the arms, you're trying to fake your shots. There's a lot more that go into a takedown than just a shot. I believe 1 point was just awarded to
Richie.
So he has a 3-1 lead. And if he can get him down the mat, he's got, nope, couldn't quite do it. No takedown.
This has been a dandy of a match here between Haas and Richie, and we still have a minute 40 left and maybe more after that.
This would be quite a blow to the Howard Express. You know, they've been adding up points here along the way. They've had three guys in the finals. Three guys in the finals. This would be a fourth. That would mean a lot to team points. So, you know, this would be kind of a blow to that run for Howard. But, you know, Logan Richie's a quality kid. He's been wrestling a lot of years and been very successful. And when you have a brother to wrestle with, plus you have a college, kind of a high school icon, Logan Storley, that's kind of your mentors, of course you're going to be good.
Updated team standings. Bottom Scotland, 7 points ahead of Parkston. Then Canton trails by half a point of Parkston for third. Howard in fourth spot.
We better call this one before it's over. We got on mat three, match 321, we have Trevor Lensing of Wagner, 38-1, going against Brady Hicks of Bennett County. He gets the quick fall over Brady Hicks. Brady Hicks had a tremendous quarterfinal victory over Jerry Kapperman, who was 44-1. A lot of people had Jerry Kapperman going all the way to finals. He defeats him, but Trevor Lensing, defending state champ, comes back and gets the quick fall. You don't see that very often in these semifinal matches.
Certainly not that quick.
No.
Lensing, by the way, he was the Floyd Farron winner at 182.
Right.
Meanwhile, they're going to hold up, I think, the action on mat three here. They don't want to get too many weight classes ahead.
Richie and Haas. He doesn't have two yet. All he has to do is get him back down the mat, and he has two there. A little bit of an upset here with Logan Richie earning a 5-1 win, joining his brother in the finals. Great match by Richie to defeat a very, very good wrestler in Caleb Haas of Howard.
Meanwhile,
that might shut the door on Howard's chances
I believe so. Meanwhile, we have Turner Blasius of Kimball White Lake Plankington taking on Lucas Forsling of Elk Point Jefferson. That is Matt 3. Meanwhile, Matt 2 will have Tyler Wagner of Webster against John Lassley of Canton.
Now this match on Matt 3, which is on the lower left of your screen, two outstanding wrestlers. Blasius is rated number one, has defeated some of the good quality wrestlers in the weight class, Semler being one of them. Blasius beat Forsling earlier. Forsling's the defending state champ, I believe. Yeah, he's defending state champ. So we have a good match here. And right now, Blasius of Kimball White Lake Plankington with the early takedown. And is really wrenching that shoulder to turn him over on that far side half. And you can see the, you know, the pain that wrestlers have to go through sometimes when they're on the bottom getting pinned. They just wrench those shoulders or those arms to where it looks just absolutely painful. Blasius with those legs in, controlling the defending state champ from Elk Point Jefferson.
And Lucas Forsling is a senior, 33-2.
And there you see Wagner with the takedown. Wagner has defeated Lassley a few times this year. Seems like their scores get closer and closer and closer the more times they wrestle. And you know, who has the advantage here? I mean, I know Wagner has beaten him two or three times throughout the year, but that puts a lot of pressure on the kid that has beaten you two or three times a year. But right now it looks like Wagner is in pretty good control.
Tyler Wagner advanced the semifinals with two fall victories. Ditto for John Lassley.
And if you notice where Lassley is from,
He's from Canton.
You know.
But Bonham Scotland still, I know, has at least one more competitor
right.
coming up, and that's a defending
right.
state champion who's
right.
been dominant in the early rounds.
He has been. Okay, there were no near points awarded on mat three between
Blasius and Forsling.
Yeah,
of course,
so.
Blasius, a name out of the Kimball area, very well known with athletics for that community over the years.
Football, wrestling, you name
yep.
it, you bet.
One of those family Wagner names.
On mat two, on the upper right hand of your screen, Wagner with a deep single leg. He needs to create an angle. He needs to get out to the side. That's a stalemate. That's usually what happens if you don't get out the side with a single or a double leg. Tyler Wagner with a 2-0 lead in the second period. And then Blasius and Forsling remain 2-0 into the second period. Forsling on top of Blasius. Blasius quickly up to his feet, and he will score the escape. Now has a 3-1 lead. Over on mat two, Wagner now gets an escape. He has a 3-0 lead. Identical scores on both mats. Again, both wrestlers are really working their setup to try and create a good shot position. You see how they're working the head, they're working the arms, they're trying to do duck unders. Whatever it takes to create an opportunity to get to those legs. It's not as easy as it looks.
If it was easy, everybody would be doing
wouldn't
it.
Wouldn't they? It's like two big old bulls killing each other out in both mats here.
And we aren't up to the 285 guys
right.
yet.
Oh, there you see Forsling tried to create a lateral drop, which is kind of a move, a throw actually, from your feet to his back. Blasius wasn't gonna fall for it. He earns the takedown. Lucky he didn't get back points against Forsling. Blasius now with a commanding 5-0 lead with 35 seconds left in the second period.
Meanwhile, we've got Tyler Wagner up 3-0 here near the end of the second period over John Lasley of Canton.
I see over in the Wrestlebacks on mat one, one of the Parks and Wrestlers from last night, Miles Semler, is wrestling, has a 9-1 lead over his opponent. One of the best matches I've seen between David Jensen, who you'll see here in just a few minutes, and Miles Semler. Jensen scores a takedown with 2 seconds left in the match to earn the quarterfinal win to get to the semifinal.
And this place was rocking when that.
Oh, my gosh. Wasn't that something?
Everybody knew that how important that match was. And Miles Semler was a Floyd Farron tournament winner.
Isn't that something?
But and he met at a top-notch opponent in the quarterfinals.
Yeah. Semler wrestling on mat one, which would be on your bottom right hand of your screen. And here's where I mentioned before, these semifinal matches, or not semifinal, but these wrestleback matches can mean just as much as semifinal matches.
The important thing is have your guys still alive on Saturday.
Absolutely.
Make it to Saturday. How many times have I heard coaches telling the guy, maybe not necessarily the number one or two ranked guy, but that guy, hey, we need you on the medal stand. Get us there.
Right. But you know the psyche of these kids after they're so close to being in the semifinals, probably in the finals, and now you're wrestling for third place. You know, there's a letdown, but Miles Sumner took care of his opponent pretty easily.
Lastly, trying to make something happen here. He's down 3-1. The Canton fans are right by mat number two on the cheering section opposite our broadcast location. So you're going to hear some make some noise. Canton, of course, bringing a huge cheering section.
They sure do. No, I don't care where the state. It can be in Timbuktu. They're going to bring a huge crowd. And you'll hear it. If Leslie can possibly score a point here on Wagner, you'll hear the crowd. We won't have to tell you about it. Right now, Wagner is up 3-1 with 45 seconds left in the match. One takedown by Lasley, and that changes the whole outlook of this match. Wagner, though, does look like he's the aggressor throughout most of this match.
39 seconds left. This is a big one for Canton. They need their wrestler to advance.
Yep. Over on mat three.
Blazius up.
Blazius still has a 7-0 lead over. Yep. Over Forson.
18 seconds and counting. Lasley took a quick glance at the clock. He's trying to make something happen. We got a warning for stalling against Wagner.
That really changes things. Oh, 1 second left. I don't think that's going to happen.
Looks like Tyler Wagner's going to advance.
You know,
3-1.
Webster has quietly put together a nice tournament. They got three guys in the finals.
They're in seventh place currently in the team standings.
Well, that's going to move them up.
And heartbreak there for John Lasley. So close in those waning seconds.
Yeah, both Richie brothers in the finals, and now they have Tyler Wagner. Tyler Wagner is one of those kids that quietly has put together a great year. Good quality wrestler from a wrestling community.
And it looks like Blazius is going to advance. He's up 9-0 with just 3 seconds left. Our next 195 semifinal, David Jensen of Mobridge Pollock against Ryan Yost of Redfield Dolan.
Now this could be, you know, the kind of match that Jensen had last night. You know what? There could be a slight letdown. There you see Jensen with, I don't think it's going to happen with Jensen, but you know.
Well, Yost is no slouch at 23-9. And he's a senior.
I've watched him for years, too. I don't care what the score is. He will throw you. You watch for a headlock. Here comes the, you watch. Yep, you got to be careful there.
11-1, Blazius with the win. Turner Blazius onto the championship.
With a very convincing win over a former state champ, I might add.
Yeah, Lucas Forsling disappointing his senior year, but he'll have to try to wrestle for third.
That's right.
Meanwhile, Yost and Jensen doing battle here on mat number two. We're up the 195 at the moment on mat two, and we'll have 220 getting underway on mat three momentarily. And that looks like it's going to be Dylan Hines against Chase Schoenhard.
Right. Schoenhardt, you know, you got to look at this now. On both semifinal matches, you have two kids from Mobridge Pollock. I can't tell you how much that means to these kids to have this kind of quality practice partners in the wrestling room every day.
Mm-hmm.
And look how it pays off. Both of these kids are fighting for a chance to be in the finals.
Well, I've seen that down in Vermilion with Rhett and Brett By and Regan By.
Right.
I mean, some of the talk about quality of a practice partner there.
Carries over to the living room too, like you said earlier.
You know? And Regan By, I believe, is going to South Dakota State to wrestle.
So that's that huge.
And that's
up
a good program.
Jacks. Huge. You know, you want to see your in-state colleges and universities that have wrestling programs not only keep their programs, but flourish. And South Dakota State slowly and steadily is getting back up to where they used to be years ago. And to have a pickup like him go to the in-schools instead of going to like Minnesota or Iowa, which he was capable
Iowa
of
State.
Doing,
yeah, yep.
being recruited by those schools, he chooses the Jacks over them. That says something about your university.
And we always like seeing that local talent, no matter what sport it is, stay
Absolutely.
Close to home. I mean,
right.
we get to see a Macy Miller go play at South Dakota State.
Right.
And some other young men and women competing in-state, whether it's at an NAIA school, whether it's out here at, say, South Dakota Tech or Black Hills State or Dakota Wesleyan or Mount Marty. Sioux Falls, of course, has done a great job recruiting in-state.
That's for sure.
Northern State is really up in that northeast part of the state. It seems like a lot of the good athletes in men's and women's sports, they get the kids out of Warner, Webster, Groton, and Aberdeen.
Right. Yep.
And it's good to
Very
see
true.
Them continue
it
and
is.
Get their education.
It is. Got some good wrestling going on here. It doesn't look like Jensen's having a letdown. There you go. See Parker Yost letting Jensen up. This is what Yost wants. He wants him on his feet. He wants a chance to be able to throw a headlock or a neck wrench or something like that. Where if Jensen lets up, I guarantee you will see some flying going on.
We have Hines scoring some points. That's 2-2 now. Hines out of Wolsey Wessington.
Right. It's kind of a new program. The quality of kids at this Wolsey Weston program is really impressive for only having a program for a few years. And I know Western Springs has had wrestling programs over the years, but they haven't combined like this to where it is a new program, led by their coach Kevin Heider, who was a couple times state champ from Redfield. They're making some noise here. And, you know, if they've only done that in a few years, that speaks volumes for the community support of that program.
And building it. And, of course, Wolsey Wessington, of course, they were in the state championship football game, and their basketball team doing very, very well this year as well. We may see the Wolsey Wessington at the State B tournament.
Very, very easily.
Meanwhile, here it is Jensen in control, 14-0. As
I kind of smile when I say that because I guarantee you, Yost, he could make a difference. I mean, he get to his feet, he'll throw you. I've seen it, I don't know how many times I've seen Parker Yost throw kids, and he's behind in the match. I think he's just setting them up, I don't know.
Maybe. Well, 14-0, he's pretty close to a technical fall loss here.
With 13 seconds left in the second.
Jensen just so good.
He is good.
I tell you what, I hope people were watching that quarterfinal yesterday between Semler and Jensen. That was one for the ages.
It really was. And, you know, I know his dad pretty well, and I know his dad goes into wrestling around with him. His brother wrestles for Nebraska.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of those quality kids that we saw a few years ago win the state title for Mobridge Pollock. And, you know, I got to say this, too, because they're not only great wrestlers, they're good kids. You know, they're good kids. They'll do whatever they're asked of. And why is it those are the type of kids that are so successful?
Hard work,
coachable. Yeah.
Work ethic, good family, good values.
That's right.
Self-motivated.
There you see Parker. He's trying to make that throw, that headlock. I told you, 14-0 doesn't matter.
He's going to stick to his game plan and try to do what he does best.
I don't think Jensen is going to fly. There you go. And, oh, look at that. He's close, and he does get a headlock. He's not points yet for it. Jensen is bellied out. He's got two. Now, if I was Yost, I would let him back up and try it. There he goes.
Yep, he's going to try it again. Up. Oh, Jensen tried to sneak in there. Yost wasn't having any of it. Still a long way to go for Yost. He's
back on mat three if we can take our our focus away from this match and go over to mat three. It's a good match. We got Hines from Woolsey Westington that is behind, I believe, Chase Schoenhart of Mobridge Pollock.
Yep, that is correct.
4-2. 4-2. Good match down there. We have 22 seconds left in the second period.
Hines, just a sophomore, wrestling at 220.
You remember their football program? It's not too bad.
For Woolsey, you know? Westington, yes, I got to see that. And they got a young man who's playing basketball too, but going to South Dakota State to play football.
Yep. So I told you they got some good quality athletes in that neck of the woods. And I don't think Jensen's going to, you know, you see, Jensen's not trying to end this thing. I mean, he's careful. He's not going to fall for getting headlocked or something like that. I mean, that happened almost one time. He's not just going to try and end this match. He's going to be careful doing it. That's a smart wrestler. It's smart wrestling right there. But I guarantee, one opening, Yost will take it. There we see an escape point by Hines, closing the match 4-3.
10 seconds left here. Looks like David Jensen's going to be in that championship against Turner Blasius.
And that sets up for a heck of a final.
That's at 195. That one is set. Meanwhile, 220 being contested, and this one's going down to the wire between Hines and Schoenhard.
With 115 left in that match, anything can happen here. They're both on their feet, both kind of jockeying for position.
Meanwhile, mat number two. Looks like they're going to jump ahead and get the 285 underway.
This is on your top right of your screen.
Dan Stribel of Bonham, Scotland, against Chase Beitzel of Canton. So this an important one.
One of the three undefeated wrestlers in the state tournament. And I might add, one of the most dominating wrestlers in the state tournament in his weight class, too.
Stribel won in 60 seconds combined in his first two matches via fall. He is the defending state champion. He's unbeaten. Interesting note about Stribel, he missed part of the year because he had an injury at a national event right before the football playoffs. Yeah. So he missed the football playoff game for Scotland.
Right now he's got a hammerlock set up with that arm behind Beitzel's back, and he's going to try and just bowl him over. He is so strong.
Hines trying to come from behind. That's at 220.
Okay, we're down to 20 seconds left in that match. Hines the aggressor. Schoenhard is now warned for stalling. One more time, and he gets a point which would tie up the match. He's got to be careful here, because a lot of times if these wrestlers back up right away initially when the ref blows the whistle, they could get dinged again. And you see he had to stall, or I mean he backed up one more time, but match is gonna end. Great match.
Chase Schoenhard moves on 4-3 in the decision.
He joins his teammate Jensen in the finals. That'll set up a potential good match here. We have another
220 semifinals going to happen on mat number three. That'll be Austin Bertram of Parkston taking on Riley Osby of Canton. Again, another big matchup when it comes to the team standings race. Ditto for the mat number two with that 285 match underway. And Stribel in control. Try to get you an update here on the team standings, refreshing our webpage. On top is Scotland by 3 points over Parkston, 3.5 points over Canton. Webster in fourth place, they're 28 points back. So essentially we got a three-team race for the state championship.
How exciting is that? We got just a few points. 4 points separating the top three teams.
Unreal. And a strong race for fourth and fifth between Webster and Howard.
And throw Beersford in there too. I mean,
they're not out of it. They're not out of it by any stretch. Mobridge Pollock making a run too here.
You know, you see state tournaments where top two teams are going neck and neck, but when you see three teams like this that close, that just makes the finals that much more enticing to the fan, to the coaches, to the wrestlers. You know, broadcasting this and just sitting here and watching it, just thrilling to be
Absolutely.
Able to see that.
Great that you could join us here today at sdpb.org. My name's Steve Toome, along with Scott Thorson. This is the Rushmore Plaza Civic Center in Rapid City. Final day, Class B Wrestling Tournament.
And no score on mat three between those big bulls, Bertram and Ostby.
Yep, we have a 220 match on mat three, 285 match on mat two.
On mat two here, you see Stribal with a wing bar in, and if he can get that elbow up, get some leverage, he will turn over Beitzel. And you see he's getting in position, he's getting to the side, slowly. Yep, I'll tell you what, Beitzel's doing a heck of a job fighting off his back, because when you get that wing hooked up, that's hard to stay off your back. Right now he's starting to get leverage though. Stribal is starting to get leverage with that wing. If he can take one more big step, clear that leg, you'll see him go over. But he's going to run out of time. He's got 15 seconds left. And over on mat three.
Whoa. Oh. Wow.
Yep. And that's one of those things where, as a wrestler taking a kid down, you've got to be careful with that, because you've got to take that kid down under control.
Yep. You just can't slam him.
No.
And it looks like Bertram has been shaken up. Let's hope he's okay.
And here's the thing with that, because if he can't continue wrestling, the victory goes to Bertram over Ospian. And these two are so close in ability and talent that that would be a shame to see a mat like that.
I saw that happen to a wrestler from Scotland a few years ago, Joe Wallach, a state champion who his senior year got slammed in the semifinals, tried to compete in the championship. He lost. He was basically injured shoulder. They had it wrapped up. Basically, he was out there with one arm.
Right. Like I said before, I mean, to have, you know, Stribal had a wing bar hooked up, and usually when you do that, kids are going to go over. Beitzel did a heck of a job, not only fighting off that pinning combination, but keeping the score to a 2-0 match. Now, Stribal gets a one-point escape, 3-0. But just keeping it close. Keeping it close to these kids that are heavily favored. They get tight. And especially as a senior. You know, it happened. I've seen it, you know, as many years I've been in this wrestling thing. You see it every year. These kids that have been defending state champs or whatever, they get to their senior year, their final matches. It's something what happens between the years. I can't explain it. If I could, I'd be a psychologist. I'd be earning a lot more money than if I was a teacher. You know?
Here we have young man Beitzel from Canton trying to get shoot in on Stribal. Stribal having nothing of it.
Yep. And here he's in a front headlock position. If he can quickly get around behind, get that leg, which he's trying to do, there he's going to get his two.
Meanwhile, they are still tending to Bertram.
I
think they have waved it off.
Yep.
I saw the referee wave his arms. And the young man from Canton, he is very distressed. And this match is going to go to Bertram. Yep. Hopefully, he is okay, but he has not moved since he's been slammed.
Now, what does that mean for the final?
That we could have an injury forfeit in the final, for all we know. Chase Schoenhardt has advanced, but it all depends. The match has been awarded to Austin Bertram of Parkston. The question, and we certainly hope he can continue. And meanwhile, Stribal gets the win here.
The final, yeah, we were paying attention to that, you know, what happened over on mat three. Mat three, we didn't give you a final score of Stribal and Beitzel. Stribal did defeat Beitzel 5-0 to advance to the finals.
So now our only action at the moment is Peyton Jensen against Trazen Doran. Doran out of Andes Central. And I believe Jensen is out of Parker.
Parker.
Yes, indeed.
Doran with a nice nice takedown.
Doran, just a sophomore, yep. Trazen Doran. Peyton Jensen, he's a senior at 53-3.
Oh, there you see a quick turnaround in point or in positions there. Jensen gets a reversal, puts Doran to his back, and I believe he's going to pick up three near fall. Just like that. You don't usually see big guys scramble quite that quickly and score points quite that quickly.
Meanwhile, they are still tending to Austin Bertram over on mat number three. And they've rolled him on his back. Let's hopefully he's okay. As the trainers are tending to him here at the Civic Center. We hope that the young man's tournament isn't over.
What a heartbreaking way to lose a match, but also to win a match. You know, I mean, I know this kid. I know he's a competitor. He does not want to win a match like this.
Nope.
You know, and I know the fans wanted to see an entire match like this. So I know what people are thinking sometimes. Is he really hurt? Isn't he really hurt? I guarantee he's really hurt. This kid would want to finish the match. He would want to finish the match.
He is moving his limbs, which is a good sign. You always worry about something like that, but he is moving,
right.
And that's a good sign.
That is a good sign. You know, when you go, you think of the size of these boys, and when you pick a kid up over the head and you bring him down hard on the mat, with that weight and that much force, right away you think of spinal, you know? And so when you see him moving his legs, moving his hands, that's the first thing that is, you know,
as a parent, as a coach, as a fan, you want to see, you know, him eventually pop back up to his feet and walk off the mat.
It is. It's a relief to see him moving.
Yes, he is moving. Meanwhile, let's concentrate now on this match between Jensen and Doran as the trainers tend to Mr. Bertram over on mat number three. Mat two here. Doran, the young sophomore out of Andes Central, he's down 8-3. Jensen wrestling very strongly here.
We had a scramble early on. I kind of expect that every time now. Come on, guys.
All the mats are quiet except for this mat here, mat number two. All the wrestle backs are done. They'll take a break, and the action will continue probably about 20 minutes or so after they wrap up this particular match here. The final semifinal of 285. The winner gets Dan Strybel, the defending champion from Bonham, Scotland.
Right now, they're kind of jockeying for position. These big guys don't move, you know, like a 132-pounder. You know, they have to set up their opponent. They have to do arm drags. They have to pound on the head. They don't usually go in for single legs and double legs, obviously, because they are, you know, you try and do a single leg and you have a bunch of weight fall on you, it's not gonna work. So you don't see these big guys doing that. Usually what you'll see is getting around behind, you know, having an ankle drop or some kind of a move. There, he's setting up for a headlock. They both kind of are in that arm tie position. But it's not that these matches are boring. I like to watch these matches because there's a lot more strategy that go into the takedowns than you might think. So right now, they're looking at how can I get behind this kid? How can I throw him? And you can see how their legs play such a big role, and right there. Yep, and right to his back.
So Peyton Jensen with the win as the Parker fans cheer on. The senior advances to the state championship match, and that is going to wrap up our semifinals. So we are going to take a break here, and we will come back at you at 5 Central, 4 Mountain Time tonight with live television coverage on SDPB2. You can continue to watch online here at sdpb.org. In fact, we'd like to know where you're watching us from. Send a note to our webmaster at sdpb.org. In years past, we've had people from around the world watching these state championships, you know, family and friends that around the country and around the world. We've had former foreign exchange students who want to keep track on their classmates from years past they'll send us. We got lab messages from Santiago, Chile last year,
I believe.
So it's great. So do contact us. We'd like to hear from you.
Well, as a wrestling fan, I've appreciated the years and years that you guys have done these broadcasts, and it just seems to keep getting better and better and better every year.
And we thank the people out there for their support of South Dakota Public Broadcasting and the broadcast and webcast of the various state events here. Before we check out, I'm going to check the team standings
here. I believe they haven't awarded the Parkston Wrestler team points yet, so I believe going into finals tonight, or at least the fourth-round wrestlebacks, Parkston will be in the lead.
Actually, Scotland, Bonham Scotland up by one over Parkston. Canton in third place. They are 13.5 points behind Canton. So it's a three-team race between Bonham Scotland, Parkston, and Canton. Webster is in fourth. They're a half point ahead of Howard for fifth place. And then about 9.5 points behind Howard is Beresford. So that's how the top six spots wrap up at the moment. We're going to step away and they're going to take a break here. The webcast will continue. The broadcast tonight, again, at 5 Central, 4 Mountain Time on SDPB2 television. For Scott Thorson, I'm Steve Toombs, signing off temporarily. This is the Rushmore Plaza Civic Center and the State B Wrestling Tournament on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.